The Speaker recognizes the Honorable John Olumba.
Honorable Speaker, I appreciate you today and recognize me to make my farewell comments. Before I get into them, and I just am asking for your latitude as I make my way respectfully through my comments. And it's just rather strange to me. Seems that some people have anticipated the speech that I would give. I have a sense of that there's like something in the air, so to speak, like even like maybe a little bit of fear about some of the things that I might say. But through this process, Mr. Speaker, I found that often people have tried to marginalize or even trivialize the things that I would say as if they don't matter, as if nobody's listening, or as if I haven't had an effect on this process. But I think it's rather ironic that today, when I go to give my speech, that there are a number of individuals I can tell by the body language that are quite concerned about the words that I might deliver. The fact of the matter is I know the effect that I've had on this chamber since I've been here. And I'm going to close out with my farewells, and I'll be gone. But I hope that for my family and my friends and my district and a few friends that I've made here, that they will remember the changes and the difference that I made while I served in this sometimes magnanimous chamber. Miles Davis, All Blues, was first released in 1959 on one of the greatest jazz albums of all time, Kind of Blue. It opens in the middle of a room, like a room in a building, like the Parthenon, where great philosophers reason, or maybe in a barbershop on a Saturday morning where the fellas gather to kick it back and forth, or in a house, like in a home, maybe in a living room or a dining room after dinner, or even in a house like this house, like the Michigan House of Representatives. Miles, Cannonball, and Coltrane on a trumpet, alto sax, and tenor sax help us to understand what discourse and reason is like, but end up giving us a peek at what it means to be a leader. Three leaders come together to discuss an issue of the day. The first one speaks, and then the second and the third all sound very convincing, but it's clear that by the time the tenor sax speaks, whose argument carries the day to most people listening. The deepness and the volume of the tenor sax is too much to ignore. Coltrane takes the day again. The piano, Wynton Kelly, closes everything out with a commentary declaring Coltrane virtues propaganda. Somehow, for someone like me, I just knew that what one of the saxophones had said would be what people and the media would talk about. The one you expect to hear, the one everyone is repeating, and since everyone has been programmed to groupthink, everyone declares that the answer of the saxophone is correct. Miles is masterful in his piece, because through the composition, one can see that the saxophones essentially repeat the same argument. They must. They are the same instrument. They simply play at differing pitches. The trumpet, played by Miles himself, is less talked about, yet as understood by those who really understand what it's like to make music. They know that that trumpet carried the day. Miles Davis, the trumpet player, composed the song. He wrote it. What's the likelihood that he composed the song in such a way that the trumpet was somehow off key? I came here after law school, and after which I mopped floors in Starbucks while I was working to help the homeless men of Detroit. I grew up on the east side of Detroit under pretty serious poverty and hard circumstances. It taught me real humility, not like the sort of humility that people today, when they accept an award, get up on the stand and say, I'm truly humbled to receive this award. Not that type of humility. The place I came from taught me that coming from nothing proved to me that God's grace is sufficient. I ran into Sam Riddle. Some of you all may not know who Sam Riddle is, but some of you do. He was at the gym when he first got out, spent some time in the penitentiary for political corruption. He told me that he had been following some of the things that I had been doing in my first term. This he said to me, he said, the stuff you're doing is pretty brilliant. Seems like you're pretty smart. But I'm going to tell you, you're going to have to be careful in politics, because doing the sort of things you've been doing and saying the sort of things you've been saying, at times you're going to find yourself that you're too far out in front, like in front of the people. They won't always understand what you are doing, and then folks will work that against you. I attempted to orchestrate a filibuster on the emergency manager stuff, which the Dems themselves, because of inside politics, blocked and blew the opportunity. A year after I had initially proposed that filibuster that Kate Siegel called a nuclear option, the Dems tried to run that play. I saw it on Rachel Maddow. They didn't run the play right. Poor leadership and lack of skill. I just chuckled. An entire year to catch up, and you blew the play. When I left the Dems caucus more than a year back, people called that crazy. I said the party is erroneously moving away from its core at the urban center. It has no real agenda for African American and minorities. We're not a priority, as shown by the committee appointments. Detroit, one of the highest tax places to live in the country, has no representation on tax policy, where there are no people of color there. And go figure. I'm really sick of the high taxes in Detroit. And I guess what I'm trying to see is if Brian Banks can get with Tim and correct that intentional mishap. Oh yes, I digress. So anyways, I left the Dem caucus about 2 years back, and then this year, 30 African American officials left the Dem caucus in Missouri to form their own caucus. Missouri has a Democratic governor, and they did that over the same arguments and issues I've been talking about 2 years ago. I've worked with them recently on some issues. They backed a Republican for county exec in a Democratic county. He lost by 2,000 votes. A Libertarian candidate ended up taking 7,000 votes away from him, but they had almost made the difference. The Democratic governor in Missouri is still pressing in the same direction. He's hard of hearing. I can admit when I'm wrong, though. Without going too deep into it, I was wrong on some things as it pertained to our governor. I can understand now some of what he was trying to accomplish. I appreciated the fact that the emergency manager that he did appoint in Detroit was not of the same brand of local yokels that have been hanging around before. And for that matter, I think he did a fine job in handling the bankruptcy. Shout out to Rick, the governor re-elect. As I move into the rest of my speech and shout people out, I want to take the time to note that Rick did not start the idea of shouting people out. I'll give him credit for trying to reinvent the shout out for the rest of y'all. But we've been shouting out for a long time now, and it never really stopped where I'm from. I was proud to be a part of the Detroit package and closely involved in the negotiations. Some people didn't want me to be a part of that. But God saw to it that my name is crystallized in the history as someone who made a difference at a time when Detroit needed it most. And he worked through the governor and Sally Durfee and the speaker pro tem, John Walsh. Special shout out to John and Sally on that one. I think you know what I mean. Shout out to Uncle Clemenza. I sat between he and Barb Byram when I first came. I was intended to sit near the leadership. It was something that Rep. Womack had engineered and actually pulled it off. Some of us had hit it off early, and he wanted us all to sit near where the influence would be. Chanel Jackson, in a random move, grabbed the seat that I was supposed to sit in. It would have been next to Harvey Santana. But from seat 100, where I actually sat, I still imposed an influence on the left side of the aisle through various maneuvers and things. And during that process, Uncle Clemenza always lended perspective, while Barb Byram kept a record of the events and things said. It makes sense now to me that she'd be a clerk. We were right across the aisle from the Republican caucus, and I would often speak over and past Barb to Joe Hovman and Kurt Heise, who at first, I think he never wanted to be seen in a conversation with me. After all, he's been trying to get a hold of Detroit's water system since they switched him off of Similac as a baby, and he first tasted that fine DWSD product. He knew right then that he just had to have it. Back then, Ellen Lipton flanked my back right. We were fast and hard friends. Still one of the only ones I would say that I had while I was up here. That's pretty deep. It's amazing what this process will reveal to you and some of the things that it does while you're here. Still one of the smartest ones on the floor. We haven't spoken quite a while. I think she definitely gets the process. But getting it doesn't always mean you do what is just and righteous with it. My first term can be characterized by just saying, I threw a series of right-hand haymakers. Not many could handle them. I even threw a couple at the speaker. I think of anyone, he was able to handle them. I guess that is the cloth that he's made of and show why he's the speaker. Rick Hamill, Woodrow, Stanley, Kate Siegel, everyone hoped that the haymakers would stop and that Womack would definitely be the one to do it. Nearly the entire Democratic establishment surely thought so. And they were wrong for like the millionth time. Although I never hit Womack with a haymaker, I jabbed him. And to many people, dismay came when they saw me come back for a second term to caucus with the Dems, which didn't last long. A lot of stuff I did or said took courage, calling for investigations and the such, resulting in convictions, that sort of thing. When I came here, I thought the place would be full of it, like teeming with just courage. And that was just a theory. In truth, this place is dominated by fear. That's what I found out. Most people are moved by their fear of things, fear of what might happen or what somebody might say or what might happen in the next election. And I've been ashamed of that because most people that are not inside these walls, they make believe that we're the most courageous people in this state, the ones who are going to be tough when it tough gets going. I wanted no part of that fearful attitude. I've been knowing the 23rd Psalm my whole life, and all of a sudden became real to me once I was elected. I prayed it so many times since I've been here. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me down the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk down the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for he is with me. His rod and his staff comforts me. He prepares the table before me in the presence of my enemies. He anoints my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I know that Harvey really, 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 really likes that one sentence. He prepares the table before me in the presence of my enemies. Good luck, Harvey. The Lord has equipped me since I was born with this mechanism. It's built in. Built into me. And I seen it in my mother and my great uncle James Bevel, a well-known civil rights leader, in the day when folks were getting lynched and beaten and jailed. Not like today where civil rights leaders get their own TV shows. This mechanism built in and never allows a circumstance to faze me. That's like a word that we often use in the hood. It means someone with a stolid demeanor. It's synonyms with deter, daunt, intimidate, discourage, upset, shock, throw, or confuse. I never allow any circumstance to faze me. I see all things working together for good, no matter how others perceive it. And it's that unshakable faith that God will prevail, and so will those who love him, that keeps me going. Right here, I'll parenthetically insert the vow of silence I took, which was in 2012, around this time. I shaved my head bald, stopped talking, and I figured, why should I? People seldom change each other's minds up here. You can see how, ironically, I've come full circle from that time. We're at the same time of year, and it seems as though I refuse to cut any hair on my body. It's just a little bit of irony there. And besides, I decided that I wanted to start talking again, so I wrote this very long speech. I'm making up for lost time. One of the photos that survived when I was doing that was one of me standing at the desk of the speaker, and we were passing notes. It was either him or someone else, but I remember writing, "It's okay. I'm only keeping silent. You can talk." That was the beginning of what I would say was one of the more fun and fulfilling friendships and relationships I've had while up here. My bad on the news reporter thing, Jace. Thanks for holding me down, POP. The speaker actually wanted to understand what I was trying to get at. He did understand it. I think once or twice we came back after the break and a new session has started, and we've been making it clear that he understood it ever since. Speaker, thanks for coming down to our city, to the hood with Big Harv, and for trying to push affordable insurance, making another appearance in the D, and proving there's always room for intelligent people to reason and work together. I once told the speaker the same thing I told the Democratic leader. When he asked me, what are you trying to accomplish? And how can I help you? I said, I have a few things, but the specifics are really insignificant. All I require is room to operate. I think Speaker JB understood that as a leader, what that means, space to operate. I didn't think that Tim did or does. Shout out to the black hand of politics, Speaker James Bolger. He helped me make a lot of firsts while here, embracing my idea of independence, ratifying Joe Hovman's decision to make me a chairman on the Appropriations Subcommittee. There were a lot of sour faces on that day, a lot of terrible commentary. A lot of people who I thought were friendly with me wrote terrible things. That's where Brandon Dillon showed his true colors. It appeared to me we were just the friends for the sake of telling good jokes. He was pissed I became chair. I know folks work hard to marginalize that fact, but I take that as part of the process. Brandon was like, John, but you never met. My response was, I never needed to. But the next person that comes after me, who becomes chair by virtue of doing what they need to do to put their constituency in a good position, they will, because this is just a start. Besides Brandon, I came here and served as chairman. You came here and you will leave, even though you will have served 3 terms, and you will never be able to say that. And it's pretty much your fault since you led the campaign team. Shout out to Joe Hov, he's huge. I told him before he appointed me that I was the gap between Banana Republic and Old Navy. And he took that and made something of it. This time, for session when it started, Marsha Wright screwed me out of my seat selection again. I forget where I was at first, but I ended up right back in the same spot as before in proximity of Kurt Heise. Few others really, I mean, how's that for progress? A few others who really just stepped out to bite the bullet for the many folks that really didn't really want to sit next to me. That's how I ended up with these guys. Everybody was like, who's going to sit next to him? And a few of them just were like, all right, then fine, I'll do it. Those folks, they'll never forgive me if I don't tell you all a quick story, like a joke, you know? I think we got time for a little story, like a joke. I mean, I've heard they've agreed not to gavel people down and give them all the time they needed for these farewells. I was thinking about speaking until January 1st and getting grandfathered into the next session. Making history again, 111 members. So anyways, there's this black man, white woman, Puerto Rican man. And they're all sitting around this house, chilling, digging the scene. And in walks an Indian man, like, you know, like Middle Eastern, you know, not like the indigenous peoples, like curry and tandoori, but not like the Trail of Tears. You know, he walks in, and the three, the black, white, and Puerto Rican, were talking about basketball, like old school basketball. The Puerto Rican says to the black guy, you remember the finger roll? Like, you know when Kareem Abdul-Jabbar used to get up like he was gonna dunk and then just lay the ball in there? It was like a move that showed that he could finesse it. The black guy responds, you're asking me if I remember the finger roll? My uncle on my mama's side, brother's cousin, helped Kareem to invent the finger roll when they used to hoop over on the east side of Detroit in the old black bottom. The Puerto Rican laughed, but the white woman who was actually around back then and spent some time in that area doing criminal defense work came to the black man's aid. Nah, he's telling the truth. I was around back then. They invented the finger roll as a finesse move in black bottom. It was intended to show that the black man who could easily dunk and score on anyone could switch it up in finger roll if necessary. The Indian guy sits down and he's like, what are you guys talking about? The Puerto Rican says, you wouldn't understand. Plus, you know what? It's probably something that you're better off not hearing about. The black guy is testing the limits. He says, no, you know, he can hear about it. You know, let's tell him about it. And, you know, he tells him that we're talking about the finger roll. You know, the finger roll that my cousin on my daddy's mama's side invented with Kareem back in the day. The Indian looked puzzled. He said, what? What is a cousin's daddy's baby's mama? The black guy says, I didn't say that. I said nephew's cousin's niece's father. But that's neither here nor there. The white woman jumps in and says to the black man, if you know so much about the finger roll, maybe you can teach it to this Indian. The Puerto Rican says there's no way he can teach a finger roll to an Indian. Their fingers are too short. The black guy says, I know I can teach him. Let's make a wager between us all that I can do it. But I'm going to need a little bit of that Puerto Rican help and translation since, I mean, both of you guys speak the Romance languages, and I'm of Nigerian Igbo descent, and, you know, sometimes there's some communication disruption. Time went by, and under the black man's tutelage, the Indian learned a number of things. And then they took a long break in communication, and they all came back together. The white woman asked, did he learn how to finger roll? The black man said, don't ask me. Ask the Indian or the Puerto Rican. The Puerto Rican says, I think we taught him how to finger roll. The white woman says, how? It's impossible. The fingers are just too pudgy. The Indian looked up with a smile and said, you know I'm going to be the next floor leader, right? They all busted out laughing symbolically, finger rolling, to commiserate the event. The white woman asked, but wait, what did you guys exchange on the wager? She asked the Puerto Rican and the black man, and they answered her, respect. Shout out to Big Harv, Sam Singh, and Rosemary. I had fun, Big Harv. We had some ons and off, but I really respect you, bro. Sitting next to Kurt was different this time. I think we hit it off. We've had a great time, he and I and Hooker. This situation is best summed up with an inside joke. In your neighborhood, you may be used to brown squirrels. And it's always surprising and even confusing the first time someone mentions a black squirrel sighting.
Representative, I'm going to ask you to begin to wrap up your comments. Speaker, recognize you're still on. I didn't gavel you, sir.
It's a little bit of latitude. I'm going to speed it up.
It's 20 minutes. Others have stayed within our time frame.
But after initial shock of confusion, you can move past the fact of a new squirrel's coming into town. It can be quite amusing to watch the more aggressive black squirrels chase around other squirrels, and even some house cats, and at times stare down the dog. Shout out to Curtin Hook. The black race is under pressure, and I see it as one of my convictions to relieve that pressure. Our numbers on everything that is harmful to people are high. I was seriously discouraged the other day when a profound thought crossed my mind. It's going to be very hard for us as a people to rebound. I mean, close to impossible, and that's why I pray a lot. Anytime that some people's and many people's well-being is tied to your misery, you'll find that it's hard to get up. Many people have a vested interest in you not standing on your own two feet. Social worker, for instance, a fairly new occupation. I mean, it wasn't around when people had occupations like carpenter or farmer. In all the Detroit schools, we've hired 3 or 4 social workers. They get paid to help black kids through their miserable circumstance. I've seen kids placed in learning disabled and have IEPs that were perfectly normal. Sometimes it's like, if Jerome isn't good at math or reading, then he must be retarded. He can't be good at anything. Oh, my bad, we passed the law banning that word. Was I here to vote on that? I look at the police force in Detroit. Everyone is like, we need more police. Police jobs for anyone who wants to work in Detroit. Black misery, again, gives way to more job prospects. We don't need police, we need God. A renewed faith, and reuniting with him is the only force capable of stabilizing our community. We don't need any teachers in Detroit that all commute from elsewhere. Asians and Chaldeans, I swear, they should have a Black Misery Appreciation Day. They're selling fake hair and gas and Lucy's and cigarettes to people all across Detroit just hoping to catch a breath of fresh air. They're making a fortune doing it. Fred Durhall once argued against the closing of the prison in Detroit. I wasn't in disagreement with him per se. And his main argument was that closing of the prison meant the loss of jobs. I'm like, why is the irony in that? I mean, I hope you get the point. This paternal attitude on the behalf of the Democratic Party and the conjured up pity on behalf of everyone else isn't helping. I'm sure you care so much about the poor little black kids that you have to counsel and get paid $50K a year to do that. If that kid wasn't poor anywhere, where else would you get paid $50K for coddling? I mean, seriously, all the social workers and folks getting grant money to help in Detroit, and I haven't seen any positive change in all the years I've been alive. I'm glad that people receiving welfare from the state will be tested for drugs. I'm glad that people receiving welfare from the state will have a 4-year limit on what they're able to achieve and get in cash benefits. I'm glad that welfare is now attached to student attendance, a bill that I introduced as a freshman legislator. The grand old party, good on principles. I say to you, GOP, keep going. You freed the slaves once, and you'll do it again. Force us to drive these paid well-wishers from our communities under the guise of the name Democrat. It's just so crazy how so many people want to come to our community to help. Young little black boys we love so much and care so much about. But when one comes from that community who took the time out to be educated and gets a law degree and comes to Lansing to deal at arm's length with you, to tell you and to negotiate for the things that his community needs, he gets drowned out. You marginalize him because you know what's best for his folks and what they need. I'll tell you what, keep your pity, give us the respect. It's like the kids who used to say in the neighborhoods that I grew up in, you're not my mama or my daddy. What happened to all the love for the little black boy? He can't be heard when he earns a place across the table from you. Many nowadays hate to hear the name of God or see someone who prays, but they love to see a homosexual black male sitting in their office so that they can help him. The experiment for exchanging—
Representative, with respect to you and to all those who have
spoken— 2 more minutes.
All those who have spoken before you and those who will speak after. 1 more minute.
Okay. 1.5. But I mean, let's make the observation and move on. Everyone wants to be punishing everyone who doesn't agree with folks whose choice it is to be gay. To me, seeing a guy dressed up like a girl is either going to be really funny or really sad. But don't make the offense of comparing his journey to one where wearing pantyhose because he feels more secure is similar to what Martin Luther King being assassinated, or my wife's father being sprayed with hoses or bitten by dogs, or my great uncles being jailed multiple times, or to millions of people losing their lives to forced bondage and servitude. I'm exercising my right to freedom of speech, by the way, which is paramount. So don't even think about blowing up my Twitter, which I don't check anyway. I want the GOP to stick to principles, and I want African Americans to get back to our principles of once being an honorable and spiritual people who wanted to be the most thing they wanted to be was right in front of God. We don't need the media or Hollywood or industry to tell us that we need to listen to this toxic rap music. I don't digress. This is what I believe I came here for, to make things known and begin to working on those issues, and I'm not gonna stop. Shout out to Fred Durhall. When he gave his speech, he cried. I was cynical at first, but I realized what was going on with him and with my father sitting here. Fred Durhall realizes the limited time and space in which we have to make a difference and how precious that is. With the time that I got, I'm going to continue to try to make a difference.
Representative, I've given you 22 minutes.
I got
minutes.
This last paragraph. Let me close my paragraph out. That's it. Shout out to my dad and my children and my wife who invested in me and my mothers and sisters who couldn't be here. My wife, look at her. She's the one who tells me to keep going, who prays for me and strengthens me. She's an animal. She's tenacious, but loving and gentle and understanding. For most men here, if you look at a woman such as my wife, you could tell me why. If she tells you to keep going, you'll keep going. I'm grateful to God for the time that I had to spend here, but now it's time for me to go. Miles Davis and his masterpiece helped me to understand a lot of what happens in our society. Propaganda and pushing certain views to the front and lifting certain people to the top because they carry the sexiness of the alto tenor of sex, and other views get pushed to the side. What I like about Miles, though, is that he never let it get him down. You see, Miles would frequently play the horn with his back to the crowd. He was fulfilling his purpose in God when he played, when he registered his opinion. The best of us never really care what the crowd thinks. We aren't playing for your applause, the applause of the crowd here on earth. Some of you all should try it sometime. It's called courage. Those of us with it are playing for a different reason. For me, it's the reason that is as simple as fulfilling one's purpose under God, so that one day he can applaud. God bless us all.
Thank you, Representative.